Hello and welcome to our program. This is the second in a series of programs designed to help you, the healthcare professional, learn to interact with and appropriately care for your patients with dementia. Today's topic is pharmaceutical interventions for people with dementia and the appropriate use of medications. This topic has been in the media lately and has come a long way since when I started in the business 30 years ago. Medical professionals in the past used psychoactive medications with their patients with dementia to manage behaviors. But now we know that behaviors are a form of communication. And so it's really important for the medical professional to assess what's going on with the patient prior to giving a medication. We've brought together a panel of experts for you to discuss these topics further. I hope you enjoy the program.
So we have four options that the FDA has approved to treat Alzheimer's disease, and they fall into general categories or drug classes. So we have acetylcholinesterase inhibitors, so donepezil, galantamine, and rivastigmine. And then we have our NMDA receptor antagonists, and that is memantine. And the first category, the acetylcholinesterase inhibitors, those are usually used in mild or moderate, although donepezil can be used all the way up through severe Alzheimer's disease. And memantine is usually used in moderate to severe Alzheimer's. And then memantine can be used in combination with acetylcholinesterase inhibitors, although you don't usually see acetylcholinesterase inhibitors combined together. So if one acetylcholinesterase inhibitor doesn't work, you can switch to another one. You wouldn't combine them, but you can combine them with memantine.
So the theory is, in your brain, you have billions of nerve cells or neurons. And for you to do anything, to drive, to recognize your spouse, anything you do, these neurons have to communicate. So for them to communicate, they need a neurotransmitter called acetylcholine. So what your Aricept, galantamine, and Exelon do is they increase the circulating acetylcholine so this neuron can talk to this neuron because there's more of that neurotransmitter there.
So acetylcholinesterase inhibitors prevent the breakdown of acetylcholinesterase. It doesn't prevent or delay Alzheimer's disease, so it's not a cure. And the medications are moderately efficacious at best. And so that's sort of where some of the issues with, caregiver issues and patient frustration come out, is because the medications don't work great, but they do have some moderate benefit. So the NMDA receptor antagonist or memantine is used in moderate to severe Alzheimer's disease. And it works on a lot of neurotransmitters. So there's some thought that it reduces the excitability of the neuron. And it also acts on serotonin receptors and GABA receptors. It's fairly complicated, but it does improve memory and learning in Alzheimer's disease. I think that the issue with these medications, and we can talk about side effects, is... that would be more my main concern initially, is the tolerability of the medication. The acetylcholinesterase inhibitors, they can be very hard on the gastrointestinal tract, and so they have to be titrated up slowly. So if patients can't tolerate the medications from a gastrointestinal standpoint, then you have to switch, regardless of whether or not a patient's having behavior improvements or cognitive improvements. And then if you don't perceive that there's behavior improvements or cognitive improvements, then you can try a different medication in the class Then there's a washout period where you want to have the patient sort of clean of all of the medication, switch over to a different medication, and then try that for, you know, a few months. And then you can, you know, there's the third, there's three, so you could try three different options, and then try and see if you see sort of any improvement. So the one thing that I would say about monitoring for medications used in Alzheimer's disease is that these medications may not show benefit right away, and you're going to be monitoring them, any benefit for improvements in cognition and behavior over a few months, and you're going to bring your patients in and sort of assess that at sort of maybe quarterly intervals or annual intervals. But most importantly, from a pharmaceutical standpoint, your patient could present with some type of complaint that you might feel would be related to these medications, but could be a result of a side effect of another medication. Sometimes some of those side effects can manifest as behavioral disturbances in patients with Alzheimer's disease. So you could think that the Alzheimer's disease medications were not working as well, when in reality, it's the result of a side effect of an anticholinergic medication. So in addition to monitoring for efficacy of these two drug classes, I would strongly consider doing an annual medication review, an annual deep dive into your patient's medications.
What the research has shown, if you take someone off these medications when they're doing fairly well on them, there's a good chance they will decline more rapidly. And then starting them back, you won't get up as high as you were before. So really, it's not good if they're doing well on them to stop them. And this is from the research we've seen. So most professionals feel leave them on as long as we can, as long as they're doing anything functionally, cognitively, leave them on. And then when they're more total care, or we're just not seeing any benefit at all, and sometimes it is financial, unfortunately, that's when we discontinue them.
The drug-drug interactions in dementia care that I'm most concerned about, for going back to the two main FDA-approved drug classes for acetylcholinesterase inhibitors are antifungals for acetylcholinesterase inhibitors. So if you have a patient who has a fungal infection, you need to be aware that those are basically contraindicated, meaning you shouldn't be using those together. And then for the NMDA receptor antagonist memantine, bupropion is a major interaction. So that's an antidepressant that's used a lot, and it just increases concentrations because the medication's not eliminated and can cause adverse reaction. The medications that I would think twice about before I use them in patients who have dementia are, again, the anticholinergics for people who have urinary incontinence. And there are a ton of people who are older who have urinary incontinence. And so I'm not saying don't use them. I'm just saying keep a close tab on those patients. And then benzodiazepines are not my favorite, whether you have Alzheimer's or dementia or not in older adults. Increased risk of fall, increased risk of confusion. And then we talked about the atypical antipsychotics just have an increased risk of death in older adults with dementia who don't have psychotic features. Medications that are over-the-counter that I see patients taking that probably aren't the safest are, that I see all the time, is Tylenol PM. Because patients don't necessarily realize that it contains diphenhydramine. And as clinicians, we may not always be asking enough questions to know if our patients are taking something to help for sleep. So we may not be digging all the way to the bottom to know if patients are taking something occasionally for sleep. And that is something that can cause confusion. It can cause sedation. It has a hangover effect in some people. So the next day you wake up and you feel the effect of the Benadryl. And then the other one is non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs. Just those, they love water. They love to hold on to water. And then increases blood pressure, increases the water, your blood volume, which makes heart failure harder to treat. And if you have dementia and then you have all these other chronic conditions, it just makes everything else a more complicated picture. Off-label medications mean that you would be prescribing a medication for your patient that the FDA has not decided that there was efficacy and safety for that specific indication. And oftentimes patients present with a condition where you've tried everything and there are some studies that indicate that it could be efficacious and could be safe, and you need to try this particular therapy. And some drug companies decide not to pursue FDA indications for various reasons. Many drugs have not been branded for a long time, and frankly, there's nobody to pay for those FDA indications because there are application fees associated with those.
So when we speak about the different types of medications used to treat dementia, many of them are off-label. The antipsychotics are used at times for behaviors that are very hard to control, and they could be a danger to themselves or to other people. These are medications like Seroquel, Risperdal, Abilify, Geodon. We use them very carefully because they are used off-label. Their indications are for bipolar or schizophrenia, and we check many other things first before we even go to these medications. The geriatric motto is start low, go slow. So we may start at the very lowest dose, monitor the behaviors, titrate as needed. As a person progresses in the disease state, we start going down with these medications, as the behaviors will eventually also decline. Other medications we can use are the anticonvulsants, such as Dilantin, Tegretol, Keppra. These are medications used for people that have seizures. These medications can at times also help with behaviors. We are using them off-label again, so we have to be very careful. And we go by the therapeutic dose to prevent seizures because we don't have a therapeutic dose to prevent behaviors, but they can be effective. Other medications you may see are the medications for anxiety, like Xanax and Ativan. Very careful with those also, but they can decrease anxiety. Last classification you may see are the antidepressants, or the SSRIs. Lots of times we're looking at depression as a cause of some of the behaviors, and these medications can also help alleviate some of those symptoms. So when we use these medications that we're using off-label, what we look for is a change in the behavior. Some of these medications act more quickly on an individual, while others take longer. What we do is just slowly titrate up. We're not trying to make them lethargic, less responsive. We're trying to take the edge off the behavior. We're very careful to tell the families that this is not a cure. This is just a way to ease their mind, to make them more relaxed, less agitated, less restless. So it's a constant monitoring. I talk to staff a lot to say, have you seen any difference? Are they sitting more? Maybe are they participating in an activity? Will they sit through a meal? So there's a lot of things we look for to see if they're working. If we feel we're having to titrate up too high, we may switch to a different medication in the same classification and just see how it goes from there. Side effects of all these medications have to be monitored closely, especially for the antipsychotics. What we see is called Parkinsonism. It's not Parkinson's disease, but it resembles it. People can become very rigid, very stiff, have what we call cogwheeling, especially in their joints. So we constantly are asking them to move their knees, their arms, their neck, looking for any type of stiffness. We only usually see that at high dosages for a long period of time, but if someone is sensitive to the drugs, we can see these sooner. So we have to constantly monitor. The anti-anxiety drugs may be falls, but if someone is that anxious, they may tend to fall anyway. The antidepressants, usually they're very well tolerated. So in the anticonvulsants, usually it's just them not working, so we may have to switch to a different one and keeping them in a therapeutic level.
You're monitoring for other issues. So in certain antipsychotics, there are other metabolic disturbances that you're looking for. So there are increases in blood sugar, weight, that type of thing. So you're also monitoring for those as well, in addition to things related immediately to the behavioral disturbances that you're trying to treat.
So when we're ready to take someone off the medications, usually what we're looking at is they have progressed in the disease state. We're not always looking, have the behaviors improved, because they've probably improved because they're on the medication. So as we see them progress in the disease state, then we look at maybe just decreasing the medication by a tiny bit and seeing how they do. They do okay with that. It's just a slow decline, decreasing of the medication till they're finally off of it. Because the medications are off-label, we just need to be careful. What we do, we always tell the family member, the power of attorney, that we are using a medication that is not indicated for dementia. We give them why we're using it, what some of the side effects might be, and what we hope the outcome will be, which would be a decrease in behaviors. The goal of using these medications are to decrease the behaviors. Now, again, we are talking about behaviors that are a danger to the patient themselves or to others. A large percentage of people with any type of the dementias, vasculars, Alzheimer's, Lewy body, will have behaviors that are not usually socially acceptable, such as aggression, agitation, restlessness, striking out. So we do try the non-pharmacological approaches first, but sometimes we do need to go to these medications just to try to alleviate the behaviors and to give the patient more peace of mind.
The most important thing is that you know the patient well. So it's very important that you get a good history on the resident to begin with. So someone that has never had any kind of psychiatric history, there is less chance that they are going to have to stay on an antipsychotic for an extended length of time. On the other hand, if someone has always had generalized anxiety or a tendency towards depression with psychosis, then it's not very realistic to expect that at least early on in the dementia that they're going to be able to completely do without those kind of drugs. It has been shown, at least anecdotally, that as the dementia progresses, the need for the antipsychotics also diminishes. We always want to assume that any adverse behaviors are just their way of communicating an unmet need. So we always assume that to begin with. And so our job then is to try to find out what they're trying to communicate. They may be in pain. Somebody that's agitated and striking out may be in pain. So we want to try to find out whether or not they're in pain and treat that pain. They may be thirsty. They may be hungry. They may need to be toileted. There's a lot of things that cause them discomfort that they're not able to communicate to us in any other way than to act out. And so our job is to be the detective and find out what that might be. If we have gone through all of those things and tried distraction techniques and validation techniques, and none of those things have been effective in alleviating their pain, their psychological pain,
then it's time to consider a possibility of a drug to help. The goal is always to make the resident as comfortable as they can be. So we want to relieve their psychological pain. And that's the goal, whether we're using medications or whether we're using other kinds of interventions. We want to relieve their pain. We want to make it possible for them to function as well as they can in their community. If the medication makes it possible for them to rejoin their community and participate in social activities and to be more independent, to be able to accomplish some of their activities of daily living independently, then we would consider that to be a positive outcome from the use of the medicine. If, on the other hand, it makes them more withdrawn, if they're too drowsy to participate in their community, and that is not just a transient, sometimes these medicines have transient side effects like that, but if that continues, then we would we would consider that not to be a positive outcome and would reduce the medicine.
Psychiatric behaviors are classified a little bit differently, and sometimes it's really hard to tell with a person with dementia. Is it the dementia or is it some type of a psychotic episode? What we find lots of times is when we admit someone with dementia, the family is always asked, do they have any psychiatric history? Sometimes the family knows they do and sometimes they don't know. There was a stigma to that for this generation. So what we have to look at is kind of what's going on, is there a history of it? And it doesn't mean you can't develop some type of psychosis later in life. So trying to tease that out is a bit hard. There are some behaviors that are more exclusively dementia, such as the memory loss, even the restlessness and agitation. So again, it's just talking with the family, observing the patient, and the medications then, if we are using them off-label and they do have some psychosis, are going to help with that.
The causes of behavioral and psychological symptoms in dementia are numerous. Obviously, the disease itself is one of the major causes. The changes that occur in the brain increase the likelihood of poor judgment, emotions being expressed, but we also know other factors which influence it. Things around the patient, the environment, is very important because even though there are changes in cognition, the person still responds to the environment around them. Medications, illnesses, a whole range of possible factors. And this is one of the things that's very important. When you see somebody exhibiting behaviors that you may consider related only to the illness, that you need to look and make sure that these can be related to other factors, many of which are mediatable. The identification of the specific cause of the behavioral changes is exceedingly important. There are a number of models that people have, for example, the DICE model, which talks about getting information about describing what's going on with the individual, then investigating to try to figure out which of these many possible causes may be involved with this specific behavior, and then creating a program to allow you to intervene, and then evaluating that intervention. There are many kinds of things that, as I mentioned before, can cause these changes, and we need to investigate them very completely. One of the things I found in my work is that we many times will forget the impact of the environment, what's going on around the patient. For example, a lot of noise at shift change in a nursing home, and we find patients act out frequently those kinds of times, but they're really responding not just to the internal changes that are going on, but also to the environment, the noise, the activity, which may be overwhelming for them. And identifying the best intervention for a behavioral symptom is really contingent on identifying the underlying cause. For example, if the cause is something in the environment, such as too much noise, too much stimulation, too much light, or too little light, then we can change those things very readily. For example, we could change the lighting so that there's more light, so there wouldn't be shadows, which sometimes can cause problems because of misinterpretation, and then that can cause fear in the patient. So we have to identify as clearly as we can what are the underlying causes. We can do that by a number of techniques. One is obviously the observation of the patient. And I think that's really important. Many times we get the information from the caregiver, and it's filtered through the needs of the caregiver. But being able to observe directly what may be going on with the individual is very important. There's also some measurement instruments that are out there. One of the most frequently used is the neuropsychiatric inventory. It's called the NPIQ. The Q is the quick form. And this form lists a whole number of behaviors and asks for, in an interview form, to get information from the caregiver about which of these behaviors are exhibited. The long form of the NPI is very useful because it also asks about how much is affecting the caregiver and how much is impacting the individual. There are other things that measure specific symptoms, for example, looking at depression. The geriatric depression scale is widely used. There's a inventory that measures anxiety, the Beck anxiety inventory. Again, these are relatively short and can be administered directly to the patient. As the disease progresses, however, these techniques of self-report become less and less useful. And so observation becomes more important at that time. The evaluation of the interventions that are chosen is very important. As I mentioned, the DICE approach, the evaluate is the last portion because it allows us to figure out to what extent is it working, to what extent are other factors possibly involved. We now can help modify our intervention. So anytime that we engage in any kind of intervention with the patient, we need to stand back and see what's the effect. What's the effect on the patient? What's the effect on the caregiver? And many times, what's the effect on the others around them, staff, for example, in a nursing facility? The healthcare professional many times is in a situation where they're called upon to deal with the problems after they're there. The behavior is being exhibited, the family is concerned, the nursing center is calling the healthcare provider. I think it's incumbent upon the healthcare provider to first go through the questions that we talked about earlier in terms of identifying what may be the possible causes. Sometimes the assumption, even among healthcare providers, is just part of the disease when something else, which is highly modifiable, may be there. Also, to look and see if things like medication are going to be utilized. What medications make the most sense for the patient? Healthcare provider needs to look, what is the cause? What kinds of things make sense in terms of that cause? And relating directly to the caregiver as well as dealing with the patient.
Again, we first go to the non-pharmacological approaches, which is usually redirection, getting their mind on something else called validation therapy. That's where if someone is saying, I have to get home, I have small children at home, you wouldn't say your children are grown, this is your home now. They're not going to understand that. It's better to say, tell me the names of your children. You must have had a lot of fun times with your children. Enter their reality. Go back to where they're at. We have seen amazing results with that. The other thing we do is get a social history. If Mr. Jones loved to fish, he's banging on the door, he wants out, I might walk up to him and say, Mr. Jones, what's the biggest fish you ever caught? What kind of fishing boat did you have? It's like a light switch sometimes. You're moving them back into a time where they were happy. So again, you never argue, you never try to reason. This is very, very hard for families. They think, if I could just get mom to say that she's not living at home anymore, that I'm her daughter and not her mother, that means she's not as bad. But all it does is create an environment where they're arguing and the person with dementia gets more and more withdrawn or more and more agitated.
If someone is afraid, one of the best things that we can do is help distract them, because one of the things they do is lose the ability to focus on one thing for very long. And so if they are focused on something that they're afraid of, if we can move them from that position, from that spot, put them in another environment, and get their attention on something else, then I guess you could say it's even one of the blessings of the disease. The fear goes away too. Things like the sleeplessness, it's not always necessary to even do an intervention in that. If they're in a safe place like the West Center, sometimes they just get their days and nights a little bit off. And so our job then is to just make sure that they're comfortable and then just gradually help them become comfortable, help them set up a routine so that they start getting into the habit of being asleep at a certain hour. And that's just part of the disease. Sometimes they just want to be awake in the middle of the night. And that might be partly because they want to avoid the overstimulation during the daytime. Psychiatric symptoms, if you're saying like hallucinations or paranoia, suspiciousness, first of all, it's a little different with someone with dementia. You have to determine whether or not it's really a psychiatric symptom or just a factor of them not understanding. Because someone with a functional mental illness that hallucinates, their brain creates things that are completely not there. Sometimes what we call hallucinations with dementia residents is they see a shadow and they make up a reason for that shadow. That shadow may be, they may interpret it as being a person. So it's a little bit different. And so in those kind of cases, you just have to again be a detective and determine whether or not they're actually having hallucinations or whether or not they're just misinterpreting their environment. So we would change their environment. If they're in a dim room where shadows are causing them to be frightened because they're interpreting those shadows as being something that could hurt them, we move them out around people and in a lighter room. And then if those symptoms go away, then we would pretty well know that that's not a genuine hallucination. If someone is having real hallucinations, if their brain is telling them things are there that are completely not there, that's more likely to be a delirium than it is to be a product of their dementia. The suspiciousness. When you can't reliably interpret all of the cues that are going on around you, your self-protective instinct kicks in and you're going to be suspicious of everything. That's not the same thing as paranoia in, say, somebody with schizophrenia. And so our job then is to make sure that they are properly stimulated. So a lot of the times when we see somebody that's paranoid and suspicious that has dementia, it's because they're overstimulated and they're having trouble sorting out all of that stimulation, and so they're just protecting themselves. Things like apathy and depression could be an indication of being understimulated, which sometimes happens if a person who is higher functioning is in a group of people that are much lower functioning than them. So they may get withdrawn and apathetic and appear to be depressed, when in fact it's just a matter of needing the proper amount of stimulation.
My understanding of what culture change is where you really are taking the institution out of the healthcare facilities and focusing more on the individuals who live there and providing care to them in a way that they would want care provided to them, how they want it provided to them, and then when they want their care provided to them.
Well, there was an effort in the late 1980s to reform nursing home care. There was a federal law called the Omnibus Budget Reconciliation Act, or OBRA, and OBRA mandated that we make changes in clinical care and also changes in quality of life. And we spent a lot of time working on the clinical care side, but not so much on the quality of life side. So what we found was that we'd made major improvements in the type of care we provided and the quality of it, and we institutionally, we were much better organized, but people still didn't want to live in the nursing facility. And so we started concentrating on what's missing. And what we had done was institutionalized people at the end of life when they deserve more. Well, you take a look at your processes and your systems to see where you can personalize them. You start with your assessments and your scheduling of things in the center. And you ask the questions when the person comes in or when you take them on as a patient. What is their daily life routine? Especially with someone with dementia, you can't change their daily life routine.
And then I think the next step is to really focus on all of your systems in the building and analyze whether or not you are utilizing a person-centered approach to them. And what work are we doing that is required, and what work are we doing that's just extra work? And so, and before you really implement a new system or a new part to the system, really understand what is the outcome that you want from that, and how much work is that going to be for the staff members, and how much time is that taken away from the care, the staff being able to provide one-on-one care with the residents.
And that's really where the challenge comes in, because staff members have been trained in schedules and processes, and they come in with a sense of, I've got these tasks I need to get done before the end of my day. And when you say, oh, no, 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 you need to do this according to each individual person's preferences, you know, they, unless you have top-down buy-in and a commitment to get it right, and make sure that you're working with your staff all along the way and addressing their concerns, you know, if you don't have those things, you really won't get anywhere. So it's a long process. Culture change takes a long, long time, and it's not something that happens overnight. It's not something that a leader can just say, "Up, you know, we're going to change." You know, you really need to honor the old way of doing care with the idea that it does need to change.
And I think the next part of that is really effective communication. So by making sure that the staff members who are doing the care, and that they are actually setting that schedule for the day, and because they know, the especially the direct care staff, they're going to know the residents much better than anybody else.
An easy way to visualize that would be the old school way is the top-down management organizational structure, where you have someone making the decisions and then everyone else carrying them out. Person-centered care or culture change care has the resident at the center. And then the caregivers for the residents, which in our case are the nursing assistants, are right there. And that becomes the focus of all of your efforts, is what does the resident want, and do the people that are providing the care have what they need to do that? And then it goes out, you know, the nursing staff, and the administration and board and all of those folks are way out here. And once you talk to staff members about that, them being the focus and them being the important center of operations, then you get more buy-in, and they are more willing to talk about doing things the right way. One of the things that we did from an overall leadership level is we changed our evaluation form and our evaluation process. And we move the usual things that you evaluate line staff on, like attendance and appearance and getting along with coworkers. We moved all of that to the that's a minimal expectation box. And then we added in layers of understanding residents' needs and working with families and working with others and participating in problem solving and interacting in the group settings to get culture change done. And so if people want to, you know, rise to that highest level of evaluation or wage increase, then they know that they need to do more than they do at most places. They really need to participate in this process. So it once you set the whole tone of the organization that we are changing our culture, and everything you do in all of your trainings and all of your meetings and your overall evaluation system revolves around that, then it becomes much easier. Still takes time.
Yeah.
button. Mm-hmm. It's much easier.
It is a national 24/7 helpline. We're able to basically cover the entire continuum of information. And so that initial call to the helpline would be what we would call an INR, information and referral. If as the call gets a little deeper and more information is happening, say they want to know more information about the disease. You know, they want to know if they really should make that doctor's appointment. We're going to spend more time on the phone with just education. You know, all that information about what does the disease look like. And then as the level increases, you know, some folks call in more extreme situations. And that was what kind of from the information referral to what we call care consultation. Those are master's level clinicians. The other thing that's excellent about Helpline is it's not just for caregivers. It's for professionals as well. Anytime we're dealing with a disease like Alzheimer's where there is no cure, at this point we have no cure, we've got to have clinical trials. And the more individuals that we can enroll in those trials, the faster that we can move the progression of the research. And so Trial Match is a free service that matches you with trials in your area. And it's a pretty simple process. You can, again, go on ALZ.org. There's a phone number that you can call. And what it does is it gets some information from you and where you live and your age. You do need to be over the age of 18. And trials are looking for healthy individuals as well as folks that have been diagnosed with Alzheimer's disease or related dementia. And so it's going to pair you with trials in your area. So this new G code that has come out for Medicare allows them to do planning. So once the diagnosis, so we've confirmed that there's this diagnosis of Alzheimer's disease, it allows them to do an entire planning intervention and then bill for it. And that is new. There is a lot of details to it. And the good thing is the ALZ.org under the professional, there's a professional link that they can go to. And there's a ton of resources in there, one of which is this G planning code. And so they can get in and they can read everything that they would want to know about the G code.
I hope you enjoyed today's program and that you'll refer to the resources that we've provided to you at the end of the program. Stay tuned for our next program, which will cover safety issues with your patients with dementia, particularly for those patients who are still living at home.